I'm Zuntz, and I'm an astronomer, and I'm the second astronomer on this evening. You may have noticed. That isn't a coincidence. It's because outreach to astronomy, making people excited about astronomy, is just embarrassingly easy. I could just sit here showing you random selections of photographs from telescopes and of space, and you would go home perfectly happy with that kind of stuff. It's all right, that was pretty cool. So I won't have to do that. I could just sit here like showing you random like space facts like this one, and you would go home again. I'll let your mind be blown for a few seconds, and I'll resume if that's all right. Okay, cool. So see, this kind of stuff. In your own time, I'm not doing anything up here, so...
That's nothing for
me. Shall I just move? We've seen the rest of the show, and we'll watch these photos later. Would you like that? The really cool fact that you missed, because it wasn't on the screen, is that almost all the atoms in your body were forged in the cataclysmic explosion in the heart of a dying star 10 billion years ago. Facts like that are why Brian Cox has to quit particle physics outreach and come and do astronomy shit. We're pushing both back here. This is why I did really bad at experimental physics as an undergrad. He has to try and make Higgs bosons sound exciting by like being helicoptered up mountains and staying in 5-star Bermuda hotels with underwear models. It's classic. It's sort of as much as jealous, really. I'm specifically, as an astronomer, I'm a cosmologist. So I said the whole universe, my field studies everything. It's been a fantastic year. It was supposed to turn off then, don't plan it. It's been a fantastic year for cosmology. The first time I did this show back in March, we just had some really exciting results, the discovery of gravitational waves. Like the one Mark was talking about, but from the beginning of the universe, gravitational waves, which, as Mark told us, they are kind of fabric of space-time distorting in a wave-like way. So if one came through this room, I would get, like, as Mark said, you know, thinner, and then fatter, and then thinner, and then fatter, which I actually have done over the last few years. So this is exciting. This is on the front pages of newspapers, my friends on Newsnight talking about this. Even the Daily Mail managed to write a racist little opinion piece about the whole thing. It's very, very exciting. So because this all happened, when I did this show last time, I went kind of full-on arrogant, hubristic physicist, which those of you married to physicists will know. Really, really exciting. I was, you know, how fantastic it was. If you've ever seen, like, really, really geeky people being uber macho, it's fucking beautiful. So if you follow the science news, or if you're familiar with how comic anecdotes are structured, you know this isn't going to end well. Another group of scientists a couple of months ago with an even more expensive telescope, which Mike is on, for the Planck Space Telescope, made some more measurements. And they basically found that the thing all these people thought they were looking at the edge of the universe was just other stuff in between us and the thing they were hoping to look at. Which was okay, except that in part that was because they'd, making the map of the things in between, to subtract it, they had digitized a photo from somebody else's PowerPoint presentation. So that sounds like a massive fuck-up, and it's... As scientists, we're not, especially as astronomers, we're not really strangers to massive fuck-ups. The most famous one in the last few years was the Mars probe, which rather than going into a graceful orbit around Mars, decided to smash directly into the middle. Because, and this is true, someone mixed up feet and meters in the software controlling it. And again, that's an enormous fuck-up, obviously. But it's just getting anywhere near Mars is an astounding feat of accuracy and calculation. It really is. It would be equivalent of me standing here with a dart and throwing it, and a mile away hitting David Cameron in the face. Now that's quite a good joke, and most of you agreed. But I didn't tell it because it was funny. I thought it was accurate to within 10%. I'll just give you the citations back in the notes. In my normal job, I'm not allowed to lie. Up here, I am actually allowed to lie. My girlfriend Julia is at the back there, just because I feel really bad. So, of course, this kind of stuff, this kind of problem is why we double check and triple check and quadruple check all the scientific results. That's not, you know, that's the whole part of science, the whole point of science. But what you may not know is that that's not like the boring, tedious part of science. That's not the thing, oh, God, we have to do this. That's the really exciting part of science. That's the fun bit. Partly out of a kind of grand and noble sense of purpose and, you know, the philosophy of it. Mostly out of a kind of warm sense of malice and misanthropy. It's so much fun squashing someone's dream they spent months doing. It's brilliant. So I think earlier we heard we have some doctors in the audience, or medical people. You guys shouted out earlier, right? Oh, now you've gone? Okay, well then. So you guys stuff up people's bodies, and that's really cool. I admire that stuff, that's great. We have any kind of legal people or police or anything? We've got one, someone embarrassed to be the lawyer there, right? So you guys get to ruin lives, and I really admire that. That's really cool. But if you get to be a scientist, you get to ruin, you get to crush people's dreams. It's brilliant, honestly. So much fun. So the reason why I'm not actually an insane misanthrope, I'm just mostly tired of politics. Because there's a lot of politics in science now. That is because of how science has changed. And particularly astronomy. Basically, all the astronomy and all the physics you could do as one person on your own, all the Isaac Newton prisms, candles shit, all that stuff, that's all been done by Isaac Newton and other people. So we're left with the stuff that it takes loads and loads of people to do. I'm in a collaboration of 300 people using a telescope. We're like if you imagine a grand army, kind of united in purpose, seized of a common goal and marching towards it. An army where no one can give anyone any orders whatsoever. That's the situation we are in. And if someone's doing something stupid and moronic, you have two choices. Ask them nicely not to do it, or just hope they die. That's is called the Dark Energy Survey, and we are making a map of 5,000 square degrees of the sky, which is, for reference, about this much. And the 300 of us think we're going to spend a long time analysing this map, understanding it, and discovering the nature of the cosmos and its history and its future using this kind of analysis and this data. So big collaborations means big rivalries as well. There are rival collaborations doing similar kind of thing around the world. And our main rival is called KIDS, which stands for the Kilo Degree Survey, K-I-D-S, Kilo Degree Survey. And they're called Kilo Degree because they do 1,000 square degrees, not our 5,000. How shit is that, 1,000 square degrees? That's rubbish. It's like 100 trillion cubic light years. How crap is that? The problem with being called KIDS is that if you're kind of egging up the rivalry, you're in a pub, and you now yell, we're going to screw KIDS! So my job in this collaboration is analysing galaxies. Galaxies that do not look like this one. My galaxies look like this. Considerably less exciting. I've spent the last 3 years fitting tiny little circles and ellipses to pictures like this one by the hundreds of millions. And it's taken its toll on my soul. See, proper astronomers, like half of you guys out here, do not put up with this kind of shit. Proper astronomers get galaxies like this one. You know, the really cool, exciting type. These guys will be like, four, look at the spiral arms on Earth. Don't get into the mega part of it, really. And Jodie Foster, Mark brought up Jodie Foster earlier. She didn't put up with this kind of shit. You know, she was, you know, the headphones and the radio telephone and the little skirt. It was fantastic. You know, So I talked about arrogance and about malice, and the other kind of big driver of astronomy is confusion and just bewilderment. Most people in our job are either confused or bored at any one time. But that's the choice that you can make. Let's be confused there. I'm not talking about like tactical boredom, like or tactical confusion, like why is my galaxy shrieking? or you know, why is the ultraviolet bus stopped again? I'm talking bigger level, broad scale, strategic confusion. You know, like why is the whole universe accelerating? Or you know, how much money can I plausibly request for a space telescope? So I see my job up here as being like an ambassador for confusion and bewilderment, and persuading you all to be confused and have no idea what's going on. And I'll give you my favourite example, which is the Big Bang, which everyone sort of thinks they understand. Bollocks, do you understand the Big Bang? I've been doing this for 10 years and I don't understand the Big Bang, so you certainly don't. It wasn't a bang, we don't know if it was big or not yet, that's the level we're talking about here. So, science confusion, which is spam, email spam, which I'm sure you all get if you have email, you, Nigerian princes, all that kind of stuff. But we get a special kind of spam, which is mostly from middle-aged retirees, mostly like engineers or teachers, that kind of thing, who have a new, exciting, colourful, detailed theory of the universe, the physics of everything, which is somewhere between boring and wrong and batshit insane. My favourite guy is this wonderful, is Space Mirror Dude, who thinks there is one star in the universe, our sun, and a giant mirror around the whole solar system. And all the other stars are just reflections. So, and if you ask him, what the fuck are you talking about? He says, well, my theory's not really complete yet, obviously. More research is needed. So when I was writing this bit, I had this realisation, this is a science festival event, so this will attract the kind of person who sends email spam, who is this kind of person. So out there somewhere, possibly a member of my family, is someone who sends us spam email. So I'd like to take this chance to say to you, kind of face-to-face but anonymously, which is what's cool about this, that you are definitely wrong, and you are probably mad. And that goes for the rest of you as well. Thank you very much.